Survive in Advance on the Gurley Truth Sports Network. Survive in Advance is brought to you by Replenishing Care, the future of sports medicine. To find out more about their PEMF machine, make sure you go to thegurleytruth.net. Click on the banner at the top of the page. I'm your host for Survive in Advance, Mike Goodpaster. And right now, I want to welcome in my co-host, a member of the Indiana Basketball Hall of Fame, was also on the Indiana Hoosiers 1981 National Championship. Help me welcome to the show, Steve Risley.
Michael, good morning.
Yeah, it's noon where I live, so it's kind of...
That's right. It's 29 o'clock here. Yeah, I was up since 10:30 last night watching all the British Open all night long.
Really?
So, because it came on before the ESPYs ended, thank God, because that means I didn't have to watch the last half hour of the ESPYs. Although I did see the last half hour of the ESPYs because it was the most powerful thing on the night, obviously. But, yeah, hey, I have a question for you.
Sure.
On our little opening deal there, where you give the commercial, you read that off the script, you have that memorized.
I have that memorized.
That's pretty damn good. Because I'll tell you what, you nail that every morning.
Yeah, that's why I'm...
You know, imagine if we had a sponsor like Fuzzy's Vodka or TaylorMade Golf or Ping or Izod Clothing would sponsor our show. Imagine how crisp and clear that message would come across to someone like that every morning.
It would, because pretty much everything I say comes out perfectly.
It does, I swear. I just think that those kinds of companies need to really evaluate what they're missing here with having that kind of smooth butter voice talking about their products. And we would even probably endorse Fuzzy Vodka at this time of the morning. Well, early afternoon for you.
You probably would, from what I heard about your...
I quit drinking. I quit drinking a long time ago. So.
Me too, but if Fuzzy Vodka gives us enough money, we could begin again.
There you go.
All right,
Steve. All right.
So you talked about the ESPYs a little bit. What was your take?
You know, I went into it... I don't know what to make of it. I think Danica Patrick was a, I don't know. I mean, she got better as the night went on. The whole program, it's a commercial for ESPN. And the way it's all run and done, it's like, I don't know. I was numb after it was over. I didn't have any feeling toward it at all. I'm not trying to figure out if I liked it or didn't like it. Parts of it I liked. I thought some of Danica's skits were hilarious. You know, the choices that they make for awards seem more like people that are sponsoring ESPN or playing a lot of their activities on ESPN showing there, and they want to promote their own athletes. I don't know. Well, I don't have a real opinion on it other than I got through it.
Yeah, I think the most pathetic part of tonight is when they had the red carpet for a few hours beforehand.
Oh, that was atrocious.
And
yeah, I did watch that, yeah.
How did shorts become part of a three-piece suit?
Actually, on some other guys, it wasn't a bad look. But they toned it down. They did it with tennis shoes and, you know, or the high-end sneakers that they wear with them. And some of it didn't look bad. One time, Danica had a short pantsuit on, a silver one, and it didn't look bad on her either. Danica didn't look bad in anything last night. She definitely was, you know, that was the highlight of the night. As far as he was concerned, I thought, and there's a couple skits, but I don't know. It is what it is. It's a fashion show for those guys, and they have a lot of money to spend. And when LeBron can afford a $45,000 suit to wear to a playoff game, you know, it is what it is. You know,
well,
I don't know.
I thought the saddest thing of the whole night was her monologue and jokes, and then you open up the internet today and see all the players that their feelings were hurt, or that, you know, the jokes were like, I think it was Long with the national anthem protest and how
yeah.
He was all upset at that. And I think it just shows the world we live in where people can't even take a joke anymore. I mean, even if it's a bad joke, who cares? It's a joke.
Yeah, and I was trying to figure out, was it bad writing or bad delivery? But then I started listening to the jokes. Some of the jokes were actually pretty funny. I think I laughed at that one. I mean, if you can't laugh at yourself, you can't laugh at anybody. And that's just kind of my theory on things. You can't take the heat. Don't sit there and start eating on other people. And I didn't think anything was too offensive. I think that, you know, it's all everything she talked about, everything in her monologue was current events. That's generally how monologues go. You kind of make fun of current events and you kind of make light of it. I think everybody gets at serious situations in real life, but this is not real life. This is an award show and a chance to go pat myself on the back for something I get paid a lot of money to do. So I think anybody that takes offense to anything like that should stay home and not come and go. It's always been part of the shtick. I mean, hell, the Oscars does it. Every award show opens up with some guy giving a monologue or a girl giving a monologue and having fun with the people in the audience. It's just part of it. They're entertainers.
Yeah, but the part
I don't take it too seriously.
The part I don't like and the part that really hurts ESPN is the fact that everything they do is political anyways. You throw this on,
right.
It's political, and I mean, it's just a bunch of left-wing propaganda, the same as what the Oscars are.
Right, yeah. So I just take it for what it's worth, get through it, you know, and move on and laugh. You're there to have a good time. You're in L.A. You're going partying in some of the biggest, swankiest restaurants and bars afterwards. You know, you got TMZ following you everywhere, and just go have a good time. And don't get bent out of shape about things. It's ridiculous.
Yeah,
you know, it doesn't lessen your cause anyway. It actually brings more light to it, as far as I'm concerned. I mean, you know, so I think that's much ado about nothing.
Yeah, and I think my biggest question was, what did you think of the actual awards themselves?
I think that there were a lot of things that won were all productions of ESPN in some way, shape, or form. Either, you know, game of the moment of the game or what. Well, I don't know. I call BS on two things. I call BS, not because I don't like him, but I call BS on Shaun White getting the Olympic Moment Award. Shaun's a great guy. He's won plenty of gold medals. And he also promotes the X Games and participates in the X Games, which is a big ticket item for ESPN. But tell me that the curling team wasn't the Olympic moment this year. I call BS. I just call BS on that. But, you know, ESPN doesn't show much curling. Oh, I think they show more after the Olympics, which says the impact it had. So I call BS on that one. I call BS on whoever didn't show up to get their award from Kate Beckinsale because she looked gorgeous last night. And this guy missed an opportunity to stand next to one of the most gorgeous women in the world. And so I call BS on that guy, whoever he is. He couldn't have been anything more important than coming in and getting an award from Kate Beckinsale. So, and if you don't know who Kate Beckinsale is, go watch the Van Helsinger vampire movies that she's done. Hard to miss. And then I'm just going to call BS on T.O., so Terrell Owens. And I'm just going to call BS on him for thinking he's doing the right thing by not showing up at the Hall of Fame induction ceremony. And I mean, you know, there are people like, you know, our friend that is for 30 years have tried to.
Robert Brazil.
Robert Brazil for 30 years has tried to get in the Hall of Fame. And there are players who know what an honor that is. And it's the ultimate sports honor is to be at the professional level and get put into your Hall of Fame. That means you are listed and recognized. And to diminish that by protesting in any way, shape, or form over something like that, I think it just shows what an idiot the guy is. And it's sad because he's a great talent.
Well, and the thing is this. This is why he wasn't a first ballot Hall of Famer.
Yeah.
It's because it's more about T.O. than it is anybody else. So the only thing he's doing here is actually showing people what an ass he is and why it took so long for him to get in.
Yeah. No, I guess all I can say, I can't paint a picture any different than that. It's disrespectful to all the guys that are in, all the guys that are sitting there that probably deserve to be in, that would get up there and cry in the speeches they would give, in the heartfelt sentiment they would thank the people that helped them all in their career. And, you know, he just decides he's going to, you know, show that I'm bigger than the NFL. I'm bigger than the Hall of Fame. Because I'm T.O. So, you know, have another box of popcorn in the end zone and have fun with it. Oh, that was Randy. That was somebody else, wasn't it? Wasn't that Johnson? That was a Bungle guy, wasn't it?
It was T.O.
Was it T.O.?
As a Bungle guy. I don't know what a Bungle guy is.
A Bungle guy is a person who dresses up in an orange and black uniform and plays in the town of Cincinnati. That's a Bungle.
Yeah. Well, what's a Colt? A Colt's somebody that wins two games a year and which is their quarterback would get hurt.
No, they're not the Colts right now. they're not the Colts right now. They're the Indianapolis Dolts.
They're the Indy No Place Dolts, and they have been for
No Place Dolts. Yeah, I'm not disagreeing with you. You know, we have two more Super Bowls in our trophy case than you do.
No, you don't. You have one.
All right. Just one. Baltimore has the other, but still, it's with the Indianapolis Colts now.
This is the thing that blows my mind about Colts fans. Colts fans have no clue about anything that has to do with the NFL. Because if you're a Colts fan and you're only going to claim that you've won two world championships, I mean, you're missing all of Johnny Unitas' championships, in 58.
Mike, replay the show. You're admitting right there that you're wrong.
No.
Mike, replay the show. I didn't say championships. I said two Super Bowls.
Oh, okay.
I did not say
you're one of those people that believes that you can't win a championship unless it was after you were born.
No, I just said we had two Super Bowls.
Yeah, but you don't.
Maybe the actual world championship in 1970, 71,
I think it was 71 when the Colts won it all, you would have been, what, 33? Do you remember a party in Indianapolis for that? I mean, was Johnny Unitas coming downtown to Indy to celebrate the championship?
We did have a parade in Indy.
You, in 1971, you had a parade for the Colts, huh?
Yeah, there was a youth football team called the Hoosier Colts.
Yeah,
and they were all in blue and white.
Did they win the Super Bowl?
They won the Super Bowl of youth football.
Yeah,
they had a little party for the Colts. Then
that's what we're talking about.
We're wasting time. I'm sorry.
It's not a waste of time. It's because I've actually heard Colts fans say this before. It is just ignorant and stupid. Let me rephrase, counselor.
We have one more Super Bowl trophy than the Bungles do.
Yeah, and they both been in the Super Bowl just as much, and you never had to play Joe Montana. Next topic, loyalty in sports with DeMar DeRozan's departure from Toronto.
Yeah.
What's your take on this? Because it seems like fans and owners are always trying to use this loyalty thing. And the problem is, and this is college sports too, because you know yourself, in 1979, if Bobby Knight would have wanted to take your scholarship, he would have just taken it. So, but if you wanted to transfer, you would have been the villain in Indiana.
Yeah, I want to be angry about it, but I really can't throw an opinion on it anymore because it's just the nature of the beast anymore. I mean, there just is no loyalty. You know, the days of guys playing for one team, one school, I mean, playing 4 years. You know, the great players ever lasting 4 years in college again is gone. That won't happen. There'll be players like my caliber of player that have played 4 years. But the great ones like the Romeo Langfords, he's not going to be in Indiana for 4 years. We'll be lucky if he's there lucky if he's there 2 years. Most likely 1 year. Realistically. So in the NBA or the NFL, any team, it's just not part of the curriculum anymore. I mean, to see the Packers stay together, the Celtics stay together, the Lakers stay together, you know, the teams that were the dynasties that won championships, those guys, they took pride in the color uniform they put on. The name on the jersey was more important than the name on the back of the jersey. And I want to be angry about it. I want to be angry at what Toronto did, because this guy apparently, you know, loved Toronto. He was beloved by the fans. And he apparently came out and said that he was told earlier in the week that he was not on the trade table. And then they just come out and, the thing that irritates me most about that deal is I don't know what they think they're getting out of the deal. They got a troublesome player for probably 1 year.
He's already saying he won't even go to Toronto right now.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, and I guess, like I said, if they just thought that Rosen was just old and they want to dump his contract and want to start fresh. But, you know, when you have the best record in the East, I mean, I think, and you got a new coach coming in, I think it's kind of hard, you know, to mess with your chemistry to that degree. But the loyalty thing is just gone away. I mean, you know, it's gone away virtually in every sport. So I think you just can't even get pissed about it anymore.
It's gone away in life itself. I mean, so we can't really blame the players and owners for doing the same thing that the fans do in their daily lives. And I think this, we've talked about oversaturation of TV and all that and why, you know, nobody wants to watch these sports as much as they once did. But this may be a bigger factor in all of it. I mean, because if You know, I'm a Cincinnati Bengals fan. In 1975, Kenny Anderson was my quarterback. In 1983, Kenny Anderson was my quarterback. And that doesn't really happen that much anymore. I mean, you look, Peyton Manning, he ends up in Denver. I don't think that was a bad deal for either side there, because I think the Colts
no.
had to let him go. But still,
right.
I mean, this stuff happened in the past where guys would be out, but it didn't happen that much. I mean, you get the occasional Johnny Unitas ends up in San Diego, but you don't get it the way it is now, where there's very few guys that, if they play 10 years, play on the same team for all 10 years.
Right. And if part of that is that guys like Unitas, they don't know when to quit the game.
Yeah.
You know, Unitas, the situation was, you know, he was a Colt, and then the Colts tried to tell him, look, you need to retire. We got to move forward. And he doesn't want to. So then he, you know, he kind of does the Babe Ruth thing where he just starts trying to latch on to some team, and it starts diminishing, you know, what people don't understand how good Johnny Unitas was as a clutch quarterback in his prime, because most people that still come in the TV era came in, you know, they remember him in San Diego or some later part of his career when he was half as good as he was. But a lot of this problem with the loyalty thing is that it's on the players sometimes. Some of the guys, like I said, they just don't know when to quit. You know, and it's just like with the Manning thing, like you said with Kenny Anderson. With Manning, to me, I get that Tom Brady probably is a better – you're going to say definitely is a better quarterback than Peyton Manning. I get that. But I'll always have it in my heart that Peyton's my guy because he played so many years with the Colts. And, you know, I accepted it when he left Denver because it was a good move on the Colts' part because they got luck. They had to do that. And basically, Manning was pretty well on the downside of things. And it was a good move for Denver just to go and stabilize their franchise for a year or two. So that was a win-win for everybody. But, you know, because of my loyalty to the Colts and to Manning, I'll always think Manning is better than Brady. And I know it's not true. I mean, I get it.
Well, then
but
you
I'll
don't
always
think
that.
You just wish that was true.
I probably do. I probably wish that was true, yeah. But the loyalty thing, I mean, I read the article that came out about that, and I can't even find fault with Toronto. I mean, you know, it's a daily paradigm shift with these guys. They have to stay ahead of everybody else. Free agency just reshuffles teams. You're going to see it happen to Golden State. I mean, this thing's not going to last forever with those guys. You know, it'll eventually erode into them too. I just don't think the era of guys all really committing to playing together and having one common goal versus a bunch of individual goals is really going to bear in. I think Golden State's about as close as you can get to that right now. But I question how long it's going to stay in that franchise before people start deciding they want to be the star and they don't want to be sitting next to Curry or whatever and be, you know, 1B versus 1A.
All right, guys.
I don't know.
We're going to go ahead. We're going to have a guest. We've got Dave Magley, who is the owner of the Basketball League, which will be joining its second year of Professional Basketball League. We're going to take a quick commercial break. We're going to get Dave on the phone, and we'll be back right after this.
Replenishing Technologies helps athletes of all levels train, recover, and perform at their absolute best. We do this by offering the PEMF 120, the world's leading pulsed electromagnetic field therapy device. Workouts, injury, and stress cause cells to lose their natural power. PEMF works like a battery charger, helping cells regain the power needed to dump toxins, take in oxygen and nutrients, and repair. 95% of athletes report less pain, increased range of motion, more energy, and they simply feel better after using PEMF 120. If you'd like to count yourself among that group, contact us at www.replenishingtechnologiesinc.com.
All right, guys, we're back on Survive in Advance, and this is a dream come true for me today because I've always wanted to do a show with somebody that was Mr. Basketball in the state of Indiana, and all I got is Steve, who came in like fifth or something. Help me welcome to the show the new owner of the Basketball League, Dave Magley. How you doing, Dave?
I'm doing fantastic. How are you?
Oh, I'm doing great, and one of the reasons we were on the show is just so I could do that to rip on Steve, but...
Well, I can't believe you pick on such a wonderful guy like that.
Magley, you don't know the half of it, I tell you. You know, it's brutal here. My idiot partner
stuff.
Gets all liquored up, like Peyton Manning used to say about Vanderjack. Like, idiot kicker gets all liquored up and then misses a chip shot field goal to win the game for us. There's my partner trying to be funny. Yeah.
All right. I wasn't trying to be funny. Everything I said was true. Dave, I know you've just bought the basketball league. You want to tell us a little bit before we talk about that, some of your background in running basketball leagues?
Sure. I played in a lot of countries and at a lot of levels, which means I wasn't very good. So I was fortunate to play in the NBA long enough for them to realize they made a gross error in judgment, drafting me too high, and ended up with Phil Jackson in the CBA playing in Albany, New York. And Albany, New York was the closest thing to experiencing Indiana high school basketball you could. Seattle wasn't a big-time D1 at the time, and the University of Albany wasn't even D1. And so we drew 3,000 people at a 3,000-seat venue, and you know, it smelled like old school Indiana, you know, the small schools in Indiana, and it just was a lot of fun. And I went from there to play in New York and a bunch of places. And then a few years ago, I had the opportunity to be a head coach and GM of a team in Canada. That led me to be I lost a 3-1 lead in the semis. So my owner thought I'd be a good candidate to be a commissioner. And I ended up being the commissioner of that league for a few years. And really loved the product and the level of play and you know, the brand that they had. And recognize that in the U.S. we had such a bigger opportunity than there because in Canada, any venue of consequence is on ice. So you've got a $5,000 conversion expense before you even get to becoming a gym and negotiate the rate with the venue. So looking at all of the wonderful markets that used to have NBA or original ABA or CBA or D-League markets, there just seems to be an awful lot of places that this could fit. And last year, we started with the league called the NAPB, the North American Premier Basketball League, and that's just quite a bit of a mouthful. And I had a partner that was 51%, and I was 49%, and this year I thought it would probably be best to go ahead and try to acquire the whole thing and change the brand so that it was just a little bit easier to market. The basketball league is about as simple as you can get, and being from you know South Bend, that's about as good as I could probably handle. So we decided to do that, and I've been real excited with the response so far.
How many teams do you have in the TBL? Well, it started off last year. Let's look at last year, the North American Premier Basketball League, because what you're building off of, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Yeah, how many teams did you operate last year?
We had 8 teams last year from it was Vancouver, British Columbia, Yakima, Washington, Nevada, Kansas City, Kentucky, Ohio, and then 2 in New York, Rochester, and Albany. And then before the season was up, we acquired 4 new expansion teams, one in Raleigh, North Carolina, one in Tampa, Florida, one in San Diego, California, and one in Bellevue, Washington. So, you know, now the goal is to make certainly sure all those ownership pieces up of the existing 8, the new 4 are brand new, so they're pretty strong, and then bring in 4 more teams, you know, preferably geographically located, that we can start creating conferences of 4. That's kind of where the magic of the travel budget works. Because if you can put a team in San Diego and Bakersfield and Reno and Mesquite, now you've got a conference of 4 teams that can play each other 24 times in 4 months, and that only leaves 8 games. If they have another conference play them each one time, that's 28. That just leaves one travel trip to another conference. At that point, the model really starts to get exciting financially. So, you know, we will have 16 this year. We'll double the size. We're a lot of interest in a lot of markets, and we're just picking the right ones.
Yeah, and I would think I coached arena football, indoor football, which were in a lot of cities similar to this. And I think the key here is the cost savings on the travel, to keep the travel down as much as possible. The other thing that I noticed is you bring up a lot how you want the communities to look at your players as role models to communicate with today's youth. I would think that would be huge because the more you interact with the community, the easier it is to draw a crowd.
You know, that's absolutely right. There clearly is a business reason for that. But the other piece is that if we can spend the time in the community, we are different. You know, when you're in Yakima, Washington, and you're a 7-foot kid that played at UW, and they walk into the classroom, they're going to go, yeah, he's not from around here. I wonder what that guy, he must be one of the Sun Kings. What's he here for? And when he tells you you're important, that's why I'm here. I'm here to tell you you're that important. And because you're that important, we need everybody to stop picking on each other. And kind of the antidote to bullying are the kids. It's not the parents and the teachers, because they're not in tune with the social media and all the things that are going on. But the kids are. They're the ones that can look out and see if somebody's eating by themselves, if somebody's, you know, pulling away, if somebody's being picked on social media. And we've got to help them understand that it's okay to be a man or woman enough to step up and say, stop. You know, just stop. Just stop doing that. Or come on, what's going on? Why are you eating by yourself? And can we hang out? And kind of become more inclusive, because as much as social media is designed to make us be more together, it's driving a lot of people away and they're becoming lonelier. And I just can't believe one school we spoke at this year in Ohio had eight kids commit eight separate incidences of suicide. When Steve and I were kids, you never heard of that. I mean, you never heard of anybody cutting themselves or hurting themselves. That just didn't exist. And now you've got these types of things that's just it's an epidemic. And with me having grandbabies, I want to make certain we do whatever we can to try to help that messaging get out stronger.
Yeah, and I think that's such a good role model. And I've often said this. I think that this is something that I would love to see our professional major sports leagues develop is more community involvement by players mandatory as part of a contract obligations or what, because one, it does reach out, and these players, even the players in the North American Premier Basketball League or the TBL now, are going to be role models to kids, because they're always going to look up to athletes and look up to basketball players and things of that nature. And if they see them out there doing good, that helps. And it also helps keep your players out of trouble too, because you give kids a lot of money and a lot of free time, and they're going to find ways to screw things up. It's been proven time and time and time again. I've always thought the professional league should say, no, you got to give us 5 hours of community service every day that you're in your home city, you know, or something like that, to where you're giving back a little bit to the community, because you are taking a lot away from the community, especially on the major leagues. And I think that's a great concept, Dave, and I really applaud you for getting your players involved in doing it and starting a vision like that, that maybe it'll be looked upon by some of the bigger leagues and say, hey, this works. He doesn't have trouble with a lot of his players. The league has a better reputation. And the community, supports us in a higher fashion. And I think there's nothing wrong with that concept at all. I applaud you for that.
Well, and these guys work legitimately about 2 to 4 hours a day. They're going to practice for a couple of hours. They might do some things on their own as far as skill development or weightlifting or training or something. But the rest of the time is dead, and especially the younger guys. They really don't know how to fill that time. And you put a young, to your point, Steve, you put a bunch of young guys that are 21, 22, 24 together living in the same arrangements. They never have that kind of freedom. You know, when you're in college, you've got to get to school early. You've got study halls. You've got training. You have a fairly full day, not as full as you do in high school, but yeah. When you get to the pros, you just have a lot of dead time. And most of our guys really want to be they don't want to just sit around. They don't want to just watch video games all day or play or get themselves in some trouble. It's not the other side of that is we're giving them skill sets that they can do after basketball. So now all of a sudden they're part of a community. So a kid comes from Indianapolis, he goes out to Yakima, Washington, he plays 2 or 3 years. Maybe he doesn't get to a higher level. Maybe this is all he wants to do, and he falls in love with the community. They love him, and he's got a job offer waiting for him, and we've done them right by giving them something greater than that. And that's kind of how we look at it, as everybody was. And from the business standpoint, Mike, to your point, corporations really want to sponsor a community engagement. They love our brand. They love our product. That's great. But they really want to be a part of something that touches lives, because I want my brand affiliated with those school businesses. We have a school day game. Each team will do this year where the kids will get there at 9 o'clock in the morning. It'll be a message that will be brought in by some type of a hip-hop group, or if it's a rural country or maybe a country group, that just talks to them about, it, again, their self-worth and value and bullying. And then we have an actual game at like 10:30. By 1:30, they're back on their buses going home. Our guys become heroes in those communities, and there's a lot of people that want to be a part of that. You put 9,000 kids in one of these venues, it's a lot of fun for the guys playing. And they get what a great school trip. What a wonderful day for them to get away, and the teachers like it, the school administrators like it. So it does give us a chance to do something really unique.
So what's the criteria for somebody? If somebody's listening right now and says, I'm interested in that, I would love to own a team, what's the criteria for them, net worth-wise, stuff like that, franchise fee, and what kind of arena do they have to have access to?
That's a great question. We have a $2.5 million net worth, and it can be a group. It doesn't have to be one individual. More than that, we really want to make sure they have some liquid capital to help operate it. The cost of the market is the market. You basically buy the market. It's, you avoid the term franchise because the tax laws are different here. But to buy that market is going to cost a couple hundred thousand dollars. That sounds like a lot of money until you start doing the math and recognizing a very similar product as the NBA G League, and they go for $8.5 million. The U.S. Soccer League, which is called USL, which is the minor league affiliate to Major League Soccer, started at $150,000, and 8 years later they're going for $6.5 million. If you do things the right way, you really can build valuation off of your investment. The wins, for an investor is, number one, they get the credit. Their brand gets better for bringing this to their community. Number two, you can get to break even and make some money in season, but it's not easy. You have to have a little bit of working capital. But number three, without a doubt, if we do this right and we hold our standards, those valuations will go up as you grow. And that's when you can really get a return on your investment. So, the market size arena, we'd like to have 3,000 to 4,000, preferably a publicly owned arena, because you can just do more things with it, probably get a better deal. It doesn't have to be 10,000, and we won't let it be 400. So it's got to be somewhere around. There's a compelling reason that the Bakersfield Jam and the D League, before the team moved back to Arizona, they had an 800-seat practice gym that they played at. But everyone was a conscious table. So it was a really high-end, sold to corporations that did really well financially, and their customers loved it because they were intimate with the brand. So you look at exceptions like that, but every market, there's got to be. I mean, Yakima, Washington had 3,000 fans in the championship game and averaged over 2, and they're 90,000 people. So you think of how many markets is that working. Probably wouldn't work in Bloomington because of the major level of basketball there, but absolutely could work in Evansville. Absolutely could work, and it does work in Owensboro, Kentucky. And you start looking at all the other markets that do not have major Division I in the town or a major pro basketball, NBA. So you've got a chance. It's unlimited where we can go.
When do you run your schedule? You want to stay away from the NBA, I'm sure. Do you run concurrent with them?
We do. We go January through April with playoffs in May. Part of the reason is just there's so stinking much talent. It's like if I was in the oil business and I lived in Saudi Arabia, you'd have a limitless amount of talent that can come. We have a lot of it. And by January, by really December, guys that didn't get the jobs they wanted in Europe or they're already cut in the G League, there's some recognizable names. I mean, we had Kevin Young from KU. We had Tyler Thornton from Duke. We had Jamario Moon and Kareem Rush and Smush Parker, older former NBA players. There's a lot of guys that are looking for jobs and love the concept of playing at home. So starting the season around then makes sense. We've played with a spring-summer concept before, but the reality is half of our market's north, and they've been shut up all year. So they really don't want to go to indoor sports once May, June happens. That's one of the things we did in Canada was we absolutely considered going to the spring-summer to get away from hockey because they dominate so much.
Yeah.
Canadians only have a 2-month summer. That's the last thing they
want to do. My question is this. You've got a high level of player, because let's face it, only so many guys make the NBA every year, which isn't that many. I mean, guys in the first round don't even make it. What do the players make pay-wise? How do you house them? Do they have to pay for their own food, or do you have deals with local businesses that take care of that for them?
Yeah, see, Mike, you could tell that you've been at this level of pool sports before with your arena football experience.
Yeah, I've seen this done so badly so many times. I actually coached the football team that was Owensboro, and we sold out first two games, and after that, nothing, because the owner never went through and got a liquor license.
That's big. Yeah. Well, what we do with the housing piece is it really varies from, some teams will put guys up in hotels, but they're hotel suites that have, kitchenettes and things like that. Others will put them up in two-bedroom apartments. quite frankly, if you're from that market and you're an owner that has a little bit of money, the smart investment is just to buy some houses.
Yeah.
And if you buy, you know, 3 or 4 bedroom houses, kind of the adage is, as long as everybody has their own room, it's a pretty good deal. So what we want to do is make certain that these guys have good housing. They get paid a $1,500 minimum per month to $7,500, depending on really their skill set, their experience, what the team needs, and the owner's pocket. I mean, there's no secret: the higher your payroll, the harder it is to make money. So if you're doing it to win a championship, and that's part of your motivation, you might pay a little bit more. If you're doing it to really bring something to the community and kind of keep your exposure down, you probably have a little lower price team. As far as the food goes, the good franchises have 4 or 5 meals a week that are either budgeted in supporters' homes or sponsors that want to see these guys. You know, there's a lot of restaurants that think for a dozen wings, some fries, and a drink, you can have each of those players come out every Thursday night, and they're pretty darn happy because they don't have to buy their own meal. So, you know, we have a lot of those types of things that go on. We pay per diems. We pay their travel to and from all the games. So it's, you know, quite frankly, if this wasn't America, meaning North America at all, we were in Europe, South America, Asia, anywhere else in the world that plays basketball, we wouldn't be called minor or semi. We'd be pro basketball. We'd be pro A. You know, in Germany, it's the BBL, but their next level down is pro A. And we would probably be considered pro A or pro B, depending on whether or not you think the NBA G League is part of the NBA. But it really is a scenario that we want to be professional. We can't beat the moniker minor, because that's just what pro baseball does. They have the bigs, the majors, then they have, you know, triple A, single A, double A, single A, and so everything else is minor. But triple A baseball is probably better than any level in the world, including Japan. So it really is pro. It's just a different level.
All right, so in-game experience, I know, is huge, like indoor football. It's big to have a team that wins, but it's even bigger to entertain people. I mean, what kind of things do you guys do differently pre-game or halftime, post-game? I'm sure you have the players go down and everybody get autographs if they want, but what sets you apart from an NBA experience, because you can have more of a personalized experience with the fan?
Well, I think that's a great point. You know, our guys come out for sit around early and they engage with their fans. They'll walk around. You'll see our guys sitting on the stands during sit around if they've already done their workouts and they're loose. But like the NBA, if you're going to be professional, you better have good dancers, you better have good music, maybe a hype man. Absolutely, every dead ball, someone has to be at center court doing something, whether it's a contest or it's a dance cam or it's a line dance that every kid gets involved with the dancers or all those things. But then after each game, it's vitally important that we have the autograph zone and the kids get to again, touch and feel these guys. Because to Steve's point earlier, you know, we've created gladiators out of our major pro athletes. They come, they practice, they go home. Some will engage with fans on the way out of the gym. Most don't. They walk as fast as they could. They're not trying to slap the kids high five on the way out or really get engaged. I was watched our Olympic team play a few years ago, and the young kid from the big kid from the Clippers that just got traded to Dallas, he was so good with the fans before the game. It was amazing. But most of those guys just went in and out of the locker room and didn't have time for anybody else. And I just think that's a piece they're all missing, because I don't know about you, Steve, but when I grew up in South Bend, if a guy came to Notre Dame, I was so, you know, excited to watch Bill Walton or somebody play. Man, I would love to touch John Shumate's hand or talk to him or get to know these guys that were great players. And you know, sometimes when they didn't treat you well, you felt kind of bad. You felt like I'm lower than them, which we really are. We're all, our athletic career is going to end, and we recognize this is just a game at some point.
Yeah, I kind of got that feeling with Isaiah about every other day. I felt privileged to get to touch his hand every once in a while too, and you know, my locker sitting next to his. So I lived at IU every day. I was sitting next to one of those gladiators that you know, and I got to carry his bags for him a couple times. Even though
I
was a senior,
I would like to bring up,
and he was a sophomore.
There's no better hype man in the world than Steve Risley. So if you put a team in LA or close to LA, Steve Risley's your guy. I think he would be a great hype man. He's even got one of those big clocks that Flavor Flav used to put around his neck.
I wear a really big watch and it looks like that. So they're like, is that a place clock? It's a little large.
Yeah. Hey, Dave, how do you go about building teams, selecting players, assigning players, finding players? What's your process? If you have a draft? I know you do combines. So, you're doing combines right now. So what's your process to get players on teams?
That's a great question. What we do is I travel the country. We'll do 29 combine events. And those are designed to, I'm coming to you. I'll be in L.A., I'll be in San Diego, I'll be in New York, I'll be in Florida. As many markets where the talent is, so that, you know, they don't stand the cost of travel that way. If a kid from Southern California wants to try out for our league, you know, they spend a couple $100 and come work out for us, not an airplane ticket and hotel fees and all that. We stand the cost of it because it's cheaper for me to travel around than all these kids that go around. And when you say that, I've seen 1,000 guys this year that have desires to play at pro basketball level and will pay for a chance to make $1,500 a month because in their mind, this is the best they can get and they can choose to go compare to someplace else. Our draft combine at the end of the year is, so all summer long, if I see a kid I really like and see Grizzly knocking down the defense, rebounding and hitting the open jay, I am not.
That ain't happening.
No, that ain't happening.
I was with Tolbert the other day, and he said that Bobby did you wrong. You should have been starting over him the whole time. But
you can tell Ray this. Knight used to come to me before every practice and said he would start me every game that I could get either Tolbert or Turner kicked out of practice in. You ask those guys how many times Tolbert and Turner got kicked out of practice. We're taking a cheap shot swing at me about halfway through practice. And Knight would come and say, Grizzly, get him thrown out and I'll start you.
That's how
I got 30 of my 37 starts at IU.
But you only averaged like a minute a game, right?
Yeah, I came right out as soon as the tip went off and Turner and Trouble went back in, but I got the start. You got my name announced.
but then the draft combine at the end of the year. So we're taking kids the whole summer. And then, again, if you haven't been picked, if you haven't been to a combine, you have one last chance, and that last chance is a two-day event, two separate-day events, and we have every team there. So 32 kids we drafted the last, in early December. By then, like last year, we had 80 guys that I picked through the year along with the draft picks that were invited to training camp. 50 of them made opening day rosters. Well, when you look at these combine events, there's no percentages that good. Most of them are 100 guys show up for one job in Iceland or something. And you know, it's kind of a money grab. Ours, every dime that goes into that goes into supporting the teams or markets that need some help. So we really use it to, you know, save the kids some money, get some exposure. And we do generate some revenue, but it's revenue that goes back into the league to help. And that's kind of the way we get guys. Now, that doesn't mean that, you know, we have coaches that were 5-time CBA champs, like Paul Wolpert in Yakima. He just came from the L.A. Lakers D-League team 2 years ago. And he's got hundreds of guys at his fingertips to pick up kids that were playing. But he still kept combine guys because they're great values. They usually play for a little bit less. They're thrilled to be there. They're great kids. And they end up being really good role players that end up becoming good, nice pros in the long run.
Okay, I got two-part question for you. First part, is there a place where – potential kids can go find out where and when these combines are held? I'm sure you got a website. You want to talk about that? I'm actually on it right now, but I'll let you talk about it. And secondly, tell me the importance and role of your absolutely beautiful wife, Evelyn. I know she's a partner in this with you and is helping you. How is that working out? Does she enjoy you being gone 29 times for all these combines? Or is she, you know, does she like it when you get out of the house? Or what's her role in this whole thing as well, too? Because I know she's got a big part in the success of this league for you guys. So, number one,
you can go to the basketballleague.net. We didn't choose .net because it's a basketball net. It's actually the basketballleague.com was taken, but we say it's that reason. But you go to the basketballleague.net and there's an icon you can click on to see where they all are and sign up through our Eventbrite system. As for Evelyn, you know, Steve, I'm one of the few people that I know that is as crazy about my wife today as I was when I met her. I mean, she looks exactly to me like the day I met her. I look like I ate that guy. It's been a terrible deal for her but for some reason she still loves me. And
you know, I've seen your wedding pictures.
Exactly. She's been around basketball and pro athletics a long time, and she's got a real heart for the community. So when you talk about the community, what a better CEO than to make certain somebody honors our vision? Because, you know, I get so swamped sometimes in everything I do to have somebody making certain that the teams are in the communities and we are working with nonprofits and we are helping them raise awareness and funds and, you know, ones that really have impact. There's a lot of issues we can help. There's abuse women shelters that need to be highlighted, raise funds and supported. There's cancer. There's the veterans. You know, we could do a camo game when everybody wears camouflage, including the players, and they auction off those uniforms to raise funds for the local vet groups. And we just could do so many things. And she did that in Canada for the team we were a part of. So she really has the background. She's a much better looking CEO and face than I am to be out in front. So we think we got a chance. There's never been a black female CEO owner of a pro league in North America. So she is like breaking a glass ceiling. And just as the Mavericks announced yesterday, they just hired a female coach, and the Spurs have been happy with their female coach. I think we're seeing even gender lines changing in pro sports right now.
All right, yeah, so, I know how important it is. I've been married 34 years as well, and I know how important that relationship is and how it fosters into a partnership. As much as it stays a love affair too, yeah, I really appreciate that because I live the same thing with my wife at 34 years old. She's not CEO of anything other than my checkbook. But that's another story.
She has found
Rodeo Drive. She knows where that thing is out here. So sadly.
Well, in my time, I honestly have never seen a paycheck. As she's managed every dime that's ever come in and out of our house. So she really does know how to work that book because I really don't care about those kind of things. I'm not a details guy. I want to just go out and, you know, when I get too close, it's like that, you're spending too much, you got to stop or whatever. But I just want to go build something and get in front of people. And I'm a big picture guy. She's much more a detailed person. So I think it's going to work well together. There's already been some trials where she's got after me some, and I got to recognize who the boss is sometimes, but it's been good.
All right, how comfortable are you with the solvency of your league? I mean, obviously you're expanding, so you're feeling like you're going to make it at least for a period of time. I mean, are you pretty solvent with everything right now? You don't see any cracks developing yet or anything?
Steve, that's a really fair question. First year probably lost more than we thought we would, to be quite frank. But we did raise a good amount of money. We've got year two. Looks real good because there's quite a few people that are looking to actually invest in the league, as well as the new teams and the revenue from combines and the revenue from sponsorships. So as a league, the solvency looks really promising. As the other big piece is standards. Now there's dozens of acronym leagues in this country that call themselves minor or semi or pro. But they don't have standards. They don't have standards of ownership. You know, Mike asked about basically what are our standards, and they don't do the things of every player gets paid, everybody wears the same uniform deal. The venues are good. The owners can afford to stand the loss if they have to. The opportunity to grow isn't there because you've got so many different weak teams, and the variables are so great. You may or may not show up. Half the leagues, they don't even play the same number of games. So, you know, we'll play a 32-game season, 16 home, 16 away, and everybody will do the same thing. And we think that those standards really build stability because with that, again, more sponsorship, more ownership in the league and investors as well as more leagues, more teams really helps us grow it.
What's the investment of a family of four, say, to come to a TBL game? What ticket prices?
No, you're going to see basically our family packs are normally around $50. If you want to have some venues, will have a $70 family pack, but that will include sodas and popcorns and stuff like that involved. But it really, if we do it right, it should compete with movies. It should compete with other entertainment pieces like that versus something that's a lot greater. You know, we don't, when we start, where our venues can be difficult is when you've got a venue that's too expensive and they charge for parking and their in-game pricing for food gets out of hand. And next thing you know, somebody's spending $100 and $150 for a, for a family of four, and we're no longer a real value. But when we can compete with that local movie theater, we're doing pretty good. So that's kind of the model we try to do.
And to give you a comparison, I mean, for a while in time, we, two other guys, and I owned season tickets to the Pacers. And we figured it out that roughly to go to see the Memphis Grizzlies and the Pacers play on a Tuesday night when we either knew the team seemed to care about winning the game or not, we were shelling out $600 to $700 a night from our family to go to a basketball game that didn't seem like the players really cared whether they won or lost anyway, because they were getting their big fat contracts.
And it's an 82-game season.
Yeah. Yeah. It wasn't economically feasible to do. So,
well, it's funny. When I was a high school coach in Florida, every year we would take our kids on a road trip. I was unique because none of my guys played AAU, but all of them got scholarships. So we had 28 kids and 11 years of scholarships in the AAU system, because I went back to the days of when you and I were kids, and we went out and found scholarships. So I took them to small schools along the way to Indiana, and we spent a week at my brother's ministry gym competing against some great players and getting some love put on us, and then we came back. But in that environment, every summer, we would go to a South Bend Silverhawks, now called South Bend Cubs, baseball game. And nothing was more fun than dollar night. I don't care who wins or loses. I don't care who's pitching. I don't care where they play. All I know is we're watching minor league baseball with 5,000 fans. It's a closed environment, so it's just can run wild around there. And I can feed them for $50 because I'm buying a bunch of hot dogs and sodas for them. And, you know, they think those bags just hooked them up, man. This was a great experience. And the whole event might have cost me $100 for 20 kids, 25 kids. It was unbelievable. So, you know, I recognize that value. And everybody's not going to be live and die on every basket and every win and loss. But, man, they'll have a lot of fun in this experience because it's cost effective.
Yeah, exactly. Mike?
My question is this. When you get a new owner – and they're in a community, do you make it mandatory for them to spend so much money on marketing? Because I've seen a lot of teams that'll go into a place and not spend any money in marketing, whether it's, you know, a small professional basketball league or a professional football team. Do you give any kind of training to the guys that are going to be your owners? I know they've got the money, but you've got to protect yourself too, because the worst thing that can happen in one of these leagues is if you have one or two teams fold, and then all of a sudden, your structure is kind of thrown off and you're missing games here or there that maybe you sold tickets to. Is there anything you do to kind of guide these ownership groups once they come aboard?
Yeah, Mike, that's again, you could tell you've done this. This year, I would argue that and I've been in this game now at the executive level for 3 or 4 years. And the first few, the answer, quite frankly, just was no. I mean, we gave them a manual on what to do, and the manual was really thick, and we probably took it from the D-League or the CBA and, you know, rebranded it to our own and said, good luck to you. Here's some advice. Here's what we do. This year, specifically with my wife, we're bringing Paul Mulkeski on as the commissioner. Just some local fulfillment guys. We're going to do a strong onboarding piece. So with each team, we will go to them and we'll say, here's your website. Here's your social media strategy. Here's your marketing strategy. Here's a smart way to spend dollars. Here's an easy, low-hanging fruit. For example, in Yakima, they don't have any courtside seats. Instead of courtside seats, they've taken tables and put them all the way around the court, and each 8-foot table is sold for $4,000. So you buy a courtside suite. You get a beautiful sign in front made by a sign company. They get to be treated as though they're pretty special with concierge service for the food and drinks and everything. And you get to treat it like it is a suite in a big venue. They have 40 of those that go for $4,000. They're adding risers behind the baskets to add more this year because they've got a waiting list of people that want to buy those. Well, again, if our average budget is around $250,000 for the whole year, you could get $160,000 to $200,000 just off of 160 to 200 seats if you market it the right way. So it's important that they understand how you do that. That it's important to understand partnering with the proper local radio shows that you may not need to spend a lot of money on, but you do have to get them in the venue. You've got to get them logoed up with your jerseys. You've got to get them proper seats and treat them great. And in exchange for that, they're going, hey, I was at the Sun Kings game just yesterday. Man, what a that fun. That Ronaldo Major is the all-time leading scorer in the D-League. Boy, is he a lot of fun to watch. And this is even better than when we were in the CBA, and the level's better. You know, so they hype the games for you. So, you know, all of those things from in-game experience is going to be a part of the onboarding process. Like I said, the marketing plan, the statistics, the live streaming, all that has to be uniform for this league to have a value. And to your point, we can't let any team fail. I mean, when you have a team struggling in the middle of the season, that's where the league has to step in and say, hey, if you can't make a payroll, then we got to get involved and help. And we'll figure out how you pay us back or what we do, whether we have to turn the team at the end of the year or whatever. But most importantly, we can't miss games, because that's where your brand goes. And we can't continue to drive the valuation up, which is the real way people can make a return on their investment. So it's vitally important that everybody does things the same way, that they do best practices the right way, they do the right marketing, and then, you know, that's what our backup is, to help them learn that, help them do it, make certain they're implemented, and then if they struggle with their form.
All right, so
in your long-range goals for the PBL, is it to remain independent and stay your own sanctioning body, or is it eventually to maybe be looked at by something like the NBA to maybe reform the G League or become kind of a feeder system into the NBA? I mean, have you thought about that, or do you have a specific idea of where you want to take that down the road?
You know, I like about the ownership piece right now for our owners, when you own a G League team, which most are now owned by the NBA franchises or the hybrids, but for the last 15 years in the D League, maybe for 20, you don't pick your players. You don't pick your coaches. You don't pick the general managers. You run the business. You run the business management, and you really, that's pretty much what you do. So for us, our guys really like having access to the guys, access to the players, and picking who's going to play for them. So that's a piece that's good. I think professional basketball is about to change drastically in the next 3 to 4 years. I think you're going to see young men that you know, with this whole thing with the sneaker deals and the one and dones, and that you're going to see guys coming out of 18 and maybe 17 and 16 and playing in leagues around the world, possibly a league like ours. You look at Ricky Rubio. He was a pro in Real Madrid at 14. By the time he turned 19 and was age eligible, he was a 5-year pro. You look at the Gasol brothers. They were 16. Dirk was 16. So there's a lot of guys around the world that aren't staying in the AAU system and playing their own age groups. They're becoming pros. Now, I'm not saying I advocate for that, but I'm saying the reality is you're going to see a younger age group playing in the NBA. And that means that recognizable names at 24 are going to be too old. The best player in college basketball the last 2 years were KU guards, Mason and Graham. Mason was the Naismith Award winner. The top player in college basketball was drafted 48th. How can 47 guys be better than the absolute best guy in college basketball? Well, the reality was he's 24, 23 years old when he graduated. And the NBA scout said if he was 19, we'd pick him in the top 10. But at 24, 23, we've wasted 5 years of him being in college. And that's, whether that's good or bad, that's just how the NBA looks at it. They want to develop these kids. That's why they're bringing all the D-League or now G-League teams closer to home, because they can do varsity JV. They can practice at the varsity in the morning and go play JV at night and get some burn and be ready to come up to the NBA. They're expanding that model in a way that's better for development. And it's better for us because they're leaving a lot of empty markets like Bakersfield and Reno and places like that that will never get another G League team because it's too far away from an NBA product.
All right, Steve, you got any final questions?
No, I think it's a very thorough presentation. I mean, I think it's definitely something that is going to be interesting to watch develop and grow. And I followed the North American Premier League last year. I got to know Dave, you know, through social media and stuff like that, and always respected his game and his basketball knowledge and acumen. So I love the fact that you beat out Whitman and Kitchell for Mr. Basketball, so I didn't have to listen to those two idiots for 3 years. So jersey.
They were, and you know, in fairness, our All-Star team was really, really skilled. We had Wallace Bryant, John Heckwood, and Landon, and we had Thad Garner from Michigan and Andre White from Louisville. And, you know, any of those guys, Jackie Moore, they could have all been Mr. Basketball. I was just a better story. I was the guy who scored 40 the day we buried my mom in the first half of the game. And know, the writers in Indiana like the story, but it'd be hard to argue I was the best player there because all those guys were awesome.
Now, Dave, let me ask you this. The good old Don Bates, All-Star game, did you win both of your games?
Yeah, we won by a lot.
Okay,
I mean,
we lost
Steve?
Both of ours. We lost because
I just wanted
to
get that clear. So Dave has
I'll tell you why
we
lost.
He's Mr. Basketball.
We lost because we had the wrong guy at Mr. Basketball. You know, they gave it to Tolbert. Yeah, he's no leader. You know, they just picked the wrong guy in 77 for Mr. Basketball.
So who would have been the right guy?
Hey, Dave, I want to know one other thing. What happened last time Indiana and Kansas picked up and played?
You know, I really don't know. I mean, I know that.
Yeah, I think one of the teams ranked in the top five or something, weren't they? One of the teams ranked in the top five?
I just remember what happened when I played against Indiana. And you know, I was fortunate to have my best game, and we beat them in Madison Square Garden. So it was
what year was that?
A pretty good feeling. It was in 81, 81, 82. So you
okay, that was after I left. Yeah, that was after Landon I left.
Landon had got hurt. They had Uwe, Dockage to come in. And
well, that
Andy
explains everything right there. Uwe and Dockage. I mean, unless you're Michael Jordan, Dockage couldn't shut anybody out except Michael Jordan. If you listen to Dockage, so that explains everything right there.
Well, it was for me. We had played the night before against St. John's and Chris Mullin, and he was pretty darn good. We played him in a double overtime game, and I played every minute. And I thought, my gosh, this is the best man-to-man defensive team in the country. And you know, with about 8 minutes to go, I had 8 points, and I'm thinking, you know, if I could hold on and we can win and I could score two more points, it would be pretty good. And I ended up getting 24 in the last 8 minutes of the game and at my career high. And Knight wasn't very happy. It was pretty cool for me because I didn't have a great recruiting visit with him. So it kind of worked out to my favor on that one.
Yeah, so Dockage guard you? Tell me, Dockage.
No, I think he started with Ted and he went to Randy and probably finished with Jimmy because, you know, remember, I was a 6'8 wing guard. I mean, I was only weighed 195 then. So I was pretty thin. So I
Kitchell couldn't guard his shadow. Kitchell couldn't guard his shadow. He could shoot.
I'll tell you what.
He is the best pure shooter Indiana's ever had. So
if Ted doesn't hurt his back, he's got an NBA career.
I agree. He's built for the NBA. He stands out there, Scottie Webben type player. Just stand out there and just shoot the ball. Don't do anything else.
I just spent Saturday with Scottie Webben because we played together in Cleveland, and that's a great comment. Except for Ted's legit 6'9". Scottie's 6'7". I mean, Ted could really be a good stretch four. And
here's the deal: Kitchell was 6'9", played like he was 6'3". So no, I'm teasing.
I don't know. He was
Ted.
I'll tell you what.
A great player.
Those all-star practices with Randy and Ted and Landon and Wallace, I mean, my gosh, they were so darn intense. Poncho Wright. I mean, I'm coming from South Bend. I could dunk a little bit, but not like Poncho. Man, Poncho was, you know, 360 windmilling, and I'm going, man, what is this? How much talent does this state have?
I was talking to Poncho on Facebook the other day. So, yeah, he and I were Facebooking. Yeah. Poncho Wright is a great player. He and I were talking about
him on Facebook. He's one of the great guys.
Now,
you know my cousin, Steve Nagy. Is that correct?
Yep, Steve was my next-door neighbor for a long time, yeah.
That's what he said. That's my first cousin. That's my mother's brother's son. And that's actually when your name really came up with family union.
Yeah, he took my money all the time on a golf course. He's a son of a buck. He never could beat him. Sneaky little shit, just like Niedermeyer. So, you know, Steve and I had many epic battles on the golf course and verbally sparring with each other. He was the only person I know who was wittier and smarter than I think I am, so...
I'm going to see him Saturday at a family
reunion. You are, Steve. A lot of people.
Yeah, well, I don't think so, but that's okay. Yeah. Perception is reality, Mike.
Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you what. I'm going to be out in California. I'm going to be out there in a few weeks, Steve. And we'll have to get together and do some dinner.
Well, look, text me. Let me know your time. You got it. Yeah. Yeah. No. I good luck to you. I mean, I'm going to keep following it. We're going to keep following on our site, Survive in Advance, and the Grilling Truth, and. You know, we're willing to help you out in any way we can, promote your stuff, work with you on things. We got a pretty good following. We're over 53 million hits a month. And over a million unique hits a month now. So we get a million new visitors coming to the site. I like to see things like this. The people are doing it for the right reasons, which I think you've got a lot of the ingredients that I would love to see in the NBA. But they'll never come because of unions and things like that. But I think if you keep your model intact, you'll succeed in a way that you and your wife will feel good about what product you're putting out there. So keep going at it. Mike, anything else?
I appreciate that, guys.
I mean, from talking to you, the one thing that always bites these leagues in the butt is when everybody has a great plan going in, and then something will happen, they'll change the plan, and then everything goes awry. I think just from talking to you, I think this will work. I wish you the best of luck because I think you're going to do this thing the right way. And I think that we could probably, plan on having you back 3 years from now to talk about your league, and you'll probably have 24 teams or more. So I think is right. I wish you the best of luck because there's a lot of guys that can still play that may not be NBA players, but they still are good enough. They deserve to get paid. And the thing is this, even if you're not the NBA G League, if a kid comes to your league and tears it up, an NBA team is still liable to sign him.
Well, that and there's a lot of $5,000 to $10,000 a month contracts around the world that are just looking for good game film and the right venue to promote them. And that's what we can do. We can really help them become that could be that product to help these guys fulfill their dreams. And we don't even do buyouts. If a guy gets a better job in Saudi Arabia in the middle of the season, God love you, go do it. And there's dozens of kids waiting to take your place.
Well,
and if
we
help them,
kids
won't be part of it.
Yeah, the great thing about that is I've had guys before that played arena football for me, and they'll get signed by a CFL team or get an NFL, and guys are like, aren't you worried since you lost him? I'm like, no, because now it makes it even easier to get a really good player because they know
exactly.
We just sent somebody to the CFL.
But that's absolutely right. Well, listen, guys, I'll let you go. I so appreciate you doing this for us, and I look forward to taking this and really promoting what you all do to the thousands of people that are starting to follow us. I think this could be a really nice relationship.
All right. Thanks, Dave.
Thanks, Dave. Thanks, good luck with it all, buddy. I'll talk to you soon.
All right, Steve. I know it had to be special to you to get to talk to somebody that used to be a Mr. Basketball in the state of Indiana.
It's always an honor to talk to anybody who gets to wear that jersey. I'm going to tell you, it is. It is. I mean, Mr. Basketballs are a special breed of people in Indiana.
He was an All-American, too. Were you an academic?
I know. Well, that shows, doesn't it? I mean, he's a smart man. I think he's got a good product. If he can stay with it, I mean, like you said, you made the great point. If he can stay with it and not have to change to start plugging holes, I think he'll be okay. I think he's got a good business model. He's doing it the right way. He's not going to try to interfere with the big dogs or whatever. And as long as he's putting a good product on the table, small communities like Yakima, Washington will support him.
Yeah.
And they'll come and do it. They get behind that. His price point is good. Take a family of four, someone to ask that. $50 for a family of four as an average to go to a game. You spend that going to Western Sizzler Steakhouse and taking them to get the all-you-can-eat soup and salad bar.
What the hell is Sizzler Steakhouse? What the hell is that?
I don't know. It's a combination of Applebee's, and Sizzler. Ponderosa, Sizzler, Texas Roadhouse. It's a general name for all of them.
All right.
anything that's got a salad bar.
You could have just said a steakhouse.
Should have just said Chili's. I want my baby back, baby back, baby back.
You have a
Chili's can sponsor us.
Chili's
can sponsor us too.
And we can sing
Chili's
it together.
Can be a good sponsor.
We can sing it together.
Yeah, we can open up every show. Well, I want my baby back, baby back, baby back ribs. Yeah, we can do that with a glass of Fuzzy's vodka.
Well, yeah,
hell, we're ready to go.
Right. Then maybe we could get AA to sponsor us later on if Fuzzy's vodka.
Yeah, no. I quit drinking.
That's what I'm saying. Fuzzy vodka's come back. We may have to.
What was the big baseball news? We got to close out with a huge baseball news that you so aptly predicted was going to happen.
Manny Machado going to the Dodgers?
How about that?
Let's see, we had
did we not call that?
Bryce called Kawhi to Toronto, and when he wrote the article like a month ago, he got all kind of hate mail. People were telling him how stupid he was, but he was right.
Yeah.
And then the other day, you bring up Manny Machado, who you call Manny Machado or whatever the hell it is.
All right. Well, I'm not a baseball fan.
Now you can say it, though, which is the great thing. So
Manny Machado.
Yeah, and I told you he would be either a Dodger or a Philly, probably a Dodger. You basically mocked me with my prediction, but it ended up being right.
There you go.
But, guys, you can listen to us tomorrow at the same time, noon Eastern on Survive in Advance. You can follow us on Twitter at Survive the Magic. You can also follow us on Twitter at Grueling Truth. You can go to the Grueling Truth Facebook page, give it a like, follow it. And you can also find Survive in Advance on Facebook. All of our shows are on iHeartRadio, iTunes, TuneIn, Spreaker, Stitcher, and now Spotify. So, for Steve Risley, Dave Magley, I'm Mike Goodpaster. You've been listening to The Grueling Truth, where the legends speak.